Where you'll share windows. Okay. All right, so let me go back to sharing. Can you see it? Yeah. Just I wanted just to recap the main headlines of metaphysical evil so that this will jog your memory for the discussion. I have been exploring the notion of metaphysical evil in Leibniz, which, as I said, is something that was unusual at the time. As far as I know, it was the first explicitly to call it metaphysical evil. I have been seeing the existing taxonomies, Augustine, Aquinas, Suarez, the distinction between natural evil and moral evil, the distinction between malum in sé and malum alteri. I have seen king and the three kind of kings, the three kind of evil discussed, introduced by King. And I have been comparing these three kinds with Leibniz, three distinctions, metaphysical evil, physical evil, and moral evil. We have then looked at a number of key tests, and I have come to the conclusion that for Leibniz, first of all, metaphysical evil plays the role of natural evil. I have offered my explanation of why Leibniz calls it metaphysical evil as opposed to natural evil. I have then reached a second conclusion, that is that the second role which metaphysical evil plays is that of creaturely limitation. And I have then discussed the lack of a proper distinction in Leibniz between negatio and privatio. I have pointed out how this was really the backbone of the scholastic ontology of evil, and I have offered my explanation of why Leibniz tacitly, without advertising it, does not really honor this discussion. And I have linked that to the Neoplatonic background in which Leibniz, or the Neoplatonic framework which Leibniz is adopting. I have seen the distinction also in Leibniz between imperfection and defect. That is the fact that there are imperfections which are non-defective and imperfections which are defective. But I have also argued that that is not quite the distinction between negatio and privatio. I have then compared the notion of creaturely limitation with the notion of creatio ex nihilo. And I have concluded by saying that Leibniz is, as it were, not afraid to introduce metaphysical evil, because in a Platonic, Neoplatonic way, he really regards the formal nature of evil to be strictly non-being. And that thinking that metaphysical evil is in some ways making creatures, insofar as creatures, in some respect, evil is hypostasizing the nature of evil, which formally is strictly that of being non-being. Platonically and neoplatonically, for Leibniz, creatures, insofar as they are good, full stop. Okay, so this is just to remind you of how this went, and let me get it. Bigger picture here, and now the handout is also available for download, so let's start with Dan and his question. You are muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Good. I'm assuming we're on the same page, but I'm curious to know what your view is. At one point, you mentioned the ex nihilo argument of creation, and you bring along the medallion that he was going to make for his patron on the binary system. Now, I think we agree that, you know, Leibniz did say at some point, ex nihilo nihil fit is absolutely absurd. It's not something that we can accept. In fact, it's in, he says at one point, it's an eternal truth. So I guess when we're talking about nothing, we're talking about non-beings rather than pure nothingness. And I was wondering, there are usually two approaches given. One could be a Neoplatonic, where somehow the emanations of God somehow create the world from, and therefore we're not talking about pure nothingness, but non-being at a certain low level, which becomes a being. The other one would be a Platonic one, where, as I think he says in the was it the ultimate or original of things? I forget how. And that somehow that essences strive towards existence. So I mean, I'm assuming you would agree that we're not talking about, you know, reminds me of the sophist, but we're not talking about absolute nothing. We're talking about some form of non-being as that from which he gives the doctrine of creation. Thank you.
No, thank you. Thank you, Dan. That's very important. Leibniz has the Christian tradition when he says that there is creation ex nihilo. This ex nihilo is not absolute in the sense that there is absolutely nothing and then creation just springs out. Obviously, there is God. So in that respect, from God. The creation is from God. But the point being that creatures all their being to God. There was not unformed matter, as you can find in Plato, for instance, which the demiurge is somehow forming. That is the sense of this ex nihilo, and is something which was not there in the Platonic Neoplatonic tradition. So it's something that Christianity, as it were, introduced in this framework, because the theologized version of Neoplatonism still needs to do what the mainstream orthodoxy requires of this reading. In that particular instance, the point I was making is that it has been noted repeatedly in that tradition that you cannot really have an emanation of the sort of the Neoplatonic, because if it's God emanating, there is no such a thing as a losing being as this emanation goes on. The idea is from God emanating, or more specifically possessing, can only God come. And that is the way in which the Trinity is explained. So they needed to find another way to explain this derivation of things from God.
Yeah, but it's not a mystery. It's a miracle. It's supernatural. But you introduce suddenly the Christian mysteries, and I'm wondering, I don't know if one needs that to give an explanation. But any event, yeah.
Yeah, no. I see what you mean. I completely see what you mean.
Okay.
Is philosophically is far from unproblematic.
Yeah. Okay, good, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, other questions? I have here Alberto.
Yeah, maybe just a finger on the question of Daniel Cook, because I've already wrote to you yesterday about this idea, this point about creatio ex nihilo and the status of creatures. And I was thinking about some text from Augustine saying that the creatio is ex nihilo, but also de nihilo, which means that the creatures are made of nothing and they still have nothing into themselves. It's the reason why you need continued creation, because they are molded with nothing, so they are creature of nothing. And I wrote to Maria Rosa some text from Bonaventura saying that the status of creatures is nihilitas. He uses a strange word to say being creature is being made of nothing. And he has also an idea of humility connected to the consciousness of being a creature. So it's just a finger, but I think it's going the same direction. I think life is with the malum metaphysicum is trying to say in another language, but something which was already partially in Augustine when he's saying it's not just from nothing, but it's still made of nothing. And this status, this condition, is a kind of limitation, a kind of malum for creature. And the most important thing is this condition is for everybody, from matter to angels. Everybody has the same status of nihilitas, because they are all made of nothing. So I think that there's something deep going back again to a Neoplatonic or a way to deal with the Neoplatonic tradition, already in Augustine and more explicitly, I think, in Leibniz when he tried to distinguish different kinds of malum. So just a thing, but I think it was perfectly in the same direction of the Daniel Cook question.
Yeah. What I would no, thank you very much for that, Alberto, and also for the references you sent me, which are very interesting for me. What I would like to add is that is important to Leibniz to interpret all that in a way which, again, does not reify nothing, nihil. So this idea that creatures are laced with nothingness still must make sure that one is not reifying this nihil. And the way in which Leibniz does that is to say that what are we talking about is limitation, that is lack of being creatures, qua creatures. They are limited. They could not be limited, because otherwise they would not be creatures, they would be God. So that's
I think this the tradition I mentioned was a minor tradition just because of this problem, because they didn't want to say nothing is a part of the composition of the things. They don't have the tools in order to make explicit this point, and this minor tradition, the theological tradition. So maybe you're right. Leibniz has more tools, and he has limitation as a conceptual tool in order to make explicit this point.
Yeah, thank you very much, Alberto. Niccolò Fioravanti.
I was wondering which kind of role can have in this this topic of the creatio ex nihilo, the concept of exigencia. The striving towards existence that characterizes all possibles, and that has a different connotation if conceived according to a whole world as a system of created or creatable things, and the individuals that each individual strives towards existence. And in this case, probably deprivation is also functional to the variety of creation. That is one of the lines according to which God creates the world. I mean, the variation, that there's also the image, the musical image of the dissonance in a composition, and Yeah, I wanted to ask which kind of how Leibniz puts the role of exigencia from especially from an ontological point of view.
Yeah. This is a very important question, and gives me the opportunity to speak of something which is key to Leibniz, and which I think it exposes that in Leibniz, as in any other thinker, I think there are certain tensions. There are certain things he's trying to do. He's trying to put together a certain ontological metaphysical framework that he thinks is powerful, explains a lot of things, and at the same time, he's trying to keep together the Christian orthodoxy to which he was also committed. And this does create a certain point, a certain tensions. Regarding this issue of the exigencia, Leibniz is very famous for his question of why there is something as opposed to nothing. And that question seems to be suggesting that the default state is nothing, and then we have to explain why there is something, and obviously that is very much in line with this creatio ex nihilo. There was nothing apart from God. From nothing, nothing comes, so there must be a God. There must have been something which is the cause of this creation and so on. However, and here is where the tension lies, and this is something that in particular Bob Adams has noted, and is this, that in fact Leibniz metaphysics deep down would have the other way around, and that is that ontologically the default is existence. And that is linked with that idea of exigencia. So we will see it later on, that things have this intrinsic drive toward existence, and they will exist unless there is some greater claim to existence from some more perfect being. And that is why, in fact, he explains the best of all possible world, why the best of all possible world wins, because it has a greater claim to existence. And that is also why he explained that the ens perfectissimum is the ens necessarium, because that is the whole framework, that what is more perfect will exist unless there is a greater claim to existence hindering this exigencia. Now, that is very nice and neat. That is work very well to argue that the ens perfectissimo is the ens necessarium, because obviously there will be no greater competing a claim to existence than the ens perfectissimum. It also works nicely and neatly for the best of all possible world. That explains why the best of all possible world wins, but somehow it doesn't really go so well with this other more mainstream Christian framework of the having nothing as the default state, and the idea that from nothing, nothing comes, as Dan was saying. And then you have to say, well, since there is something, there is the world, there must be God, who is, which is the explanation of why we have something as opposed to nothing. But as Bob Adam has noted, there is this tension there. I don't know whether this addresses what you were, as it were, pointing at, which is, it's very important. It goes really to one of the deepest metaphysical tension there, I think.
Yeah, thank you.
Other questions or comments? Okay, if not, I will move on to the next talk. And after that, we can have also a bit of time for discussion. Okay, so let me share my handout, which now you also can download. Okay, can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Good. Okay, so let me say that this is this handout is based on a paper which is now forthcoming in the volume celebrating Massimo Mugnai's work, and which is edited amongst others by Vincenzo De Risi, whom I saw joining us. So here it is. Well, if you are familiar with Leibniz and especially with the ontological argument, you will know that the notion of pure positivity plays a pivotal role in Leibniz's version of the argument. In his view, this is the way to establish the possibility of the ens perfectissimum, thereby providing the missing premise from other versions of the argument. As he puts it in the briefest of forms in 1685, here is the quotation, "The most perfect being is possible, because it is nothing other than pure positivity." Now, this is so brief that it may be tempting to dismiss pure positivity as a nastily contrived notion introduced in a desperate attempt to support the ontological argument. At least this is my experience when I do the ontological argument in my lectures. The first reaction of students is, "Oh yeah, give me a break. Now pure positivity, just a little trick to really rescue or trying to support an argument which cannot be supported." Now, in this paper, I will unpack this notion of pure positivity, exploring its links with Leibniz's conceptions of perfection, pure act being reality absolute and infinite. So my strategy in this paper is to show that the notion of pure positivity, far from being an ad hoc trick that Leibniz wheels out only when we need to support the ontological argument, pure positivity is a fundamental feature of Leibniz metaphysics. And if one takes on board pure positivity, there are a lot of other things which fall into place, I think. So let's start with briefly summarizing the role of pure positivity in the ontological argument. As most of you will know, Leibniz points out that to be unconditionally conclusive, the ontological argument must be completed as follows. So we need to add premise two. If God is possible, God exists. God is possible, therefore God exists. So Leibniz obviously was not the first one to notice that there is the issue of God possibility, but is the one which most clearly identifies the issue of God possibility not only as the pivot of a conclusive ontological argument, but also as the only genuine objections to the ontological argument. So in fact, Leibniz is quite clear that all the familiar objections that we can now go from the ideal to the real, whether existence is a predicate and so on, all in the end boil down to this key objection, whether the notion of God, the concept of God, is a coherent notion, and whether it is coherent to think that there is a being which exists by conceptual necessity, which is another way to raise the problem of God's possibility. So in the first part of his proof, he argues that if possible, so we are looking at this premise, if God is possible, God exists. So he first tackles the first premise. He argues that God, if possible, and God conceived as the ens perfectissimum, implies a logically necessary being. So basically, he sets out to show that the ens perfectissimum is the ens necessarium. Further, he proves by a model argument that if possible, a logically necessary being necessarily exists. And this is commonly accepted nowadays that it can be shown by a model argument, and there are in the handout which I have also sent yesterday, and I hope it can be also uploaded. I have also offered myself a formalization of this model argument, and there is a widespread agreement that a logically necessary being, if possible, necessarily exists. So assuming Leibniz has been successful in establishing these two points, that is, that the ens perfectissimum is the ens necessarium, and that an ens necessarium necessarily exists, he can then focus on the possibility of the ens perfectissimum without further worries that its essence, the essence of the ens perfectissimum, even if it does not involve a logical contradiction, it could still fail to exist. And why he can do that now? Because he has already shown that the ens perfectissimum is the ens necessarium. So he can just now focus on the ens perfectissimum and try to show that the ens perfectissimum is possible. So how he goes about doing that? He conceives the ens perfectissimum as the conjunction of all purely positive qualities, that is, all qualities which express without any limits whatsoever what they express. Their being purely positive means they lack any negation whatever. So Leibniz's key point is that all purely positive properties are compatible, that is, they can be in the same subject. And why is that? From a logical point of view, he reasons that which is purely positive cannot involve any formal contradiction. There would be a contradiction if two or more incompatible property are attributed to the same subject. Say there will be contradiction is two incompatible properties such as being square and being round are attributed to the same subject. Such incompatible properties, such incompatibility implies that one property is the negation of the other property, not merely in the sense that a property A, for instance, extension, is not another property B, C, for instance, thought, but in the sense that A, being square, excludes B, being round. So this exclusion or incompatibility could be expressed by an identity, A equal not B, but A equal not B is directly against the hypothesis of the pure positivity of all perfection. And here in the footnote, I have put a test in which Leibniz says, in other words, this one property would express the exclusion of the other, and so one of them would be the negative of the other, which is contrary to the hypothesis, because we assume that they were all affirmative. Okay, so if there is no contradiction, that means for Leibniz that the concept is possible. Something is possible if it does not involve a contradiction. In short, according to Leibniz, purely positive qualities must be compatible because as purely positive, they cannot involve a negation and they cannot therefore involve a contradiction. In the monadology, we find a similar thought, which is also echoing a much earlier thought of 1676, in which the same idea is given a metaphysical slant. In the monadology, he writes, "Nothing can prevent the possibility of that which is without any limits, without any negation, and consequently without contradiction. For the rest, I demonstrate that all attributes are compatible in no other way than by their being absolute, pure, and unlimited. For if they were modified by limits, they would not be affirmative, but negative in a certain manner." Okay, so this is Leibniz and using pure positivity to support the all-important second premise in the ontological argument, God conceived as the ens perfectissimum is possible. However, one could still have, a nagging suspicion that this is ad hoc. This is something that Leibniz is just wheeling out in order to rescue the ontological argument. As I said, my strategy in this paper is to say, no, this is not ad hoc for the ontological argument. Pure positivity is indeed a fundamental feature of Leibniz metaphysics, of Leibniz ontology, which tallies with a number of well-known key commitments of Leibniz metaphysics, and which cannot be detached from those well-known commitments. So I will do so by exploring the connection between pure positivity and some other key notions in Leibniz ontology. First of all, pure positivity, perfection, and pure act. As early as 1676, Leibniz identifies a pure positivity as a defining feature of what it is to be a perfection. So, if one were to ask Leibniz, what is a perfection? He would answer, short answer, pure positivity. He writes, every simple quality, which is a positive and absolute, or that expresses without, perfection is every simple quality, which is a positive and absolute, or that expresses without any limits, whatever it expresses. This is its definition of perfection. But a quality of this kind, since it is simple, is for that reason unanalyzable or indefinable. For otherwise, either it would not be simple, but one simple quality, but an aggregate of a plurality of qualities. So this is the idea that what is metaphysically primary has to be simple, and what is simple cannot be reduced, precisely because it's simple, cannot be reduced to more basic elements. So if you are able to reduce it to further elements, these elements will be what is metaphysically primary. Or if it is one, it will be circumscribed by limits. And so it will be understood that through negations of further progress, contrary to the hypothesis, for it is assumed to be purely positive. Now, as it has been noted by Bob Adams again, the most durable feature of Leibniz's conception of perfections is actually that they involve no negation of at all. So, whereas there are later tests in which Leibniz seems to be dispensing with the property of simplicity for perfection, he never dispenses with the property of being purely positive, of not involving negation at all. Now, some 20 years later, Leibniz goes as far as equating perfection and pure positivity. Perfection is a pure act, or, say, pure positivity. What we commonly say of act and potency is more correctly said of the positive and privative, or of the absolute and limited. Now, first of all, I would like to focus on this parallel between act and potency on the one hand, and positive and privative on the other. Pure positivity, Leibniz suggests, corresponds to the more traditional but less accurate notion of pure act. So he's saying the traditional notion is pure act, but it's better to think of this in terms of pure positivity. Same thing for potency. The traditional notion is potency, but a better notion which captures in a better way what the notion of potency is trying to capture is privative. So in brief, Leibniz proposes to recast the traditional distinction between act and potency in terms of a distinction between a positive and privative. Why is doing that? Why he thinks that this is better than act and potency? Well, I believe Leibniz regards the distinction between positive and privative as explanatorily superior because it reduces actuality and potentiality to a metaphysically more fundamental pair, that is, being and non-being. Being is what is positive, non-being is what is privative. And here I move to my second step, my second set of explorations, that is the relationship between pure positivity, being, and reality. Leibniz writes here, positiva is the same idem est as being. Non-being is what is merely privative, that is the privative of everything. In the definitions notionum metaphysicarum atque logicarum, pure positivity is again equated to being, ens seu pure positivum. That is what to, that is what it is to be a being, is to be positive. In the context of a very interesting explanation of existence as a function of degrees of perfection. And this is exactly this explanation of existence. Existence is a function of degrees of perfection, is exactly what I was talking about a moment ago in reply to a question, the question about esigenzia, the way in which Leibniz explained existence as a claim to existence, in which the default is to exist in a proportion, and this claim is as strong as your degree of perfection. So more perfect set of beings trumps less less perfect sets of beings which are not compossible with the more perfect. In notationes generales, perfection is equated to pure reality or seu positivity, while imperfection is equated to limitation. And here I have a number of quotation. I am not going to read them out, but I'm happy to say now you have the handout, so you can refer to them during the discussion or later on. I will just mention this. Existence is the possible, which is more perfect, or compossible with more, or that which involves more reality. And remember, reality, being, has been equated to degrees of positivity, with a pure positivity being the greatest degree of reality, pure positivity being being in its full sense. So the more perfect is what has more reality or positive entity. Again, here this notion of positivity and reality as explanations of what it is to be more perfect. In sum, there can be little doubt that the equivalence of positivity, being, and reality, all of which are employed by Leibniz to define perfection, is a well-established aspect of Leibniz metaphysics. This equivalence and its link to perfection is in itself far from novel. And here is something which is specifically relevant to what we are doing with this set of seminars. I think this is another way in which Leibniz places himself firmly in the long and multiform tradition of Platonism, with this equivalence between positivity, being, and reality. This will become even clearer, I hope, when we look at the relationship between a pure positivity and Leibniz's conception of the absolute and of the infinite. So we will end up where we began, that is with the divine infinite. P pure positivity and the absolute. Pure positivity captures for Leibniz also what it is to be absolute. So again, if you ask Leibniz, well, what is to be, what it is to be absolute, he can reply, it is to be purely positive. To be absolute is to be free from any condition and any limitation. Only what is purely positive can be absolute, since any condition is a sort of limitation, and any limitation is a negation. Therefore, an absolute quality must be a purely positive quality. If it was not purely positive, will be conditioned by some sort of limitation, and any limitation is a negation. Here I have again a set of quotations. I am not going to read them all, but you can refer to them during the discussion. However, perfection is a pure reality. That is what in essence is a positive and absolute. Perfection is pure act or pure positivity. Again, here, absolute is that concept of which unlimited or outside of which nothing can be assumed in the same kind, or the concept of which is capable of quantity and yes, does not involve limits, and so on. So you, as I said, I am not going to read them out. In sum, Leibniz ultimately explains what it is to be absolute in terms of pure positivity, that is, in terms of a complete fullness of being or reality which excludes any negation whatsoever. Now, the question now becomes, is such a pure positivity possible? That is, can a being that embraces the fullness of reality exclude any negation whatsoever? So this is another version of the question of the possibility of the ens perfectissimum. So it's all very well to say, well, yes, the ens perfectissimum is possible because it is purely positive, and pure positivity means that there is no negation whatsoever, therefore no contradiction. But we are not yet really addressing the question of whether that is a coherent notion. And in fact, the objection can be put this way. As Spinoza and Hegel have observed, and I have already mentioned it in my first talk, omnis determinatio est negatio. Any determination is a negation. The notion of a purely positive being constituted by a plurality of perfections, one could object, is not a coherent notion, since plurality implies negation. So it is not enough to say that there is no contradiction, because one property cannot be that one property excludes the other. But even if we consider that these properties are compatible with one another, the worry is that the very plurality of these perfections, of these attributes, the very plurality of these attributes is introducing some sort of negation. And why? Because property A, although compatible with property B, still is not property B. So they might be compatible, but it seems that there is still some form of negation, and therefore the worry is that the notion of a purely positive being, which involves a plurality of perfection, after all, is not a coherent notion. And that would be very bad for Leibniz. Second objection is, are all the attributes, classical attributes of God, purely positive? And a particularly tricky attribute is omniscience, because through omniscience we are saying that God knows everything, and that is he knows also finite things, and by the very fact that he knows the finite imperfect beings, is also, as it were, contemplating negations, limitations, imperfections, and is that not introducing some sort of negation? In which sense omniscience can be purely positive? Third, in 1677, Leibniz himself challenges with the following objection, Eckhart's claim that the ens perfectissimum as ens realissimum or pure positivum is the being which does not participate in any non-being, since non-being implies negation and therefore imperfection. So this is something which Eckhart proposes to Leibniz. He says the ens perfectissimum being the ens realissimum or pure positivum implies that it does not participate in any non-being, because non-being implies negation, imperfection, but the ex hypothesis, we are dealing with the ens perfectissimum, with the ens realissimum and pure positivity, pure positivum, and therefore such an ens cannot imply any non-being, any negation. And Leibniz objects, the concept of being, ens, which does not participate in non-being, non-ens, involves two aspects. One, to be, esse, the other, not to be anything, that is, to be all things. Nihil non esse, seu omnia esse. But it seems impossible for there to be a being which is all things. Of such a being, it could be said that it is you and that it is me as well, something which I take you will not admit. Now, there are many facets to this objection by Leibniz, but here I will just pick out one of these facets or aspects, and I will just comment on the fact that part of the objections is again that a plurality seems so to have all things, and therefore a plurality in God seems to introduce negation, because you is not me, and so on. So what is the reply to this set of objections, at least how Leibniz thinks that they can be dealt with? First, embracing all reality, Eckhart says to Leibniz, does not mean to be all things in their determinate essences. And here I would like to stress the word determinate essences. That is, it does not mean that God is man, brute, horse, lion, dog, Peter, Paul, you, me, and so on, says Eckhart. It means that in God there is all the perfection of all reality of all these things, but these things are not formally contained in God. In other words, as the scholastic would say, and as Leibniz himself notes en passant in his own reply to Eckhart, all things are in God, not formally, but eminently. And here we are back to what I was talking about in my first talk, the distinction between formaliter and eminenter. And it seems that Leibniz was convinced by Eckhart because he drops his objection, and we find him in 1695 in a quotation we have already encountered saying exactly what Eckhart was saying. In the divine essence, things are contained eminently. And now here we come to the issue of the omniscience, to which I will come back in a moment. We have already seen this quotation. In the intellect, they are contained somewhat more widely, indeed representatively, because in the divine intellect are represented also the imperfections and the limitations of things. Now, this fact that in the divine intellect are represented also the imperfection and limitation of things are exactly what we were seeing is a problem in considering omniscience to be a purely positive attribute of God. Because Leibniz here is saying that much, that in knowing everything, in representing everything, the intellect is representing also the imperfections and the limitations of things. So how are we going to deal with that? We will see it in a moment. But I would like, before we move to that, also to draw your attention to this part of the quotation. All things are contained somewhat more widely. And this might seem strange. Why more widely? Are we not saying that everything is contained eminently in the essence of God? Now, why is Leibniz here saying that in the intellect are contained somehow these things more widely? And I think this more widely is explained by what I have already been discussing, that is Leibniz conceiving of determinations as, or of limitations as addition. We have seen that in a number of texts. Leibniz thinks that limiting, the operation of limiting is adding something, adding a limit, adding a determination, rather than taking away something. And it seems to me that explains why here Leibniz is saying that these things which are contained eminently in God's essence are contained more widely, that is what has been added are limitations, determinations, which were not in the essence of God. And here is, again, we come back full circle to my first talk about the divine infinite and the hypercategorematic infinite. There is a hypercategorematic infinite or podestative infinite and active power having, as it were, parts eminently, but not formally or actually. This infinite is God himself. So we see here again this Leibniz using this scholastic tool of a distinction between eminently and formally. Here is my conclusion of how Leibniz is dealing with the objections which I have been raising. In order to protect the pure positivity of God, Leibniz seems to turn to a metaphysical model inspired by the Neoplatonic one. Only what is beyond all determination, or as Leibniz puts it, what is hypercategorematic, while containing eminently, not formally, all determination, can be the ontological grounding of all things, omnia, without being tainted by the negation which comes with any determination. So there cannot be formally any determination, otherwise that will be a negation. The Neoplatonic inspiration of Leibniz's thinking on the infinite is also striking, apparent in the Scienze Infiniti. And here again, we come back full circle to last week, Friday's wonderful seminar by Richard Arthur and Osvaldo Ottaviani on this very interesting, extensive test they are editing. Although, and I quote from this test, I refer to this text, although all natures capable of the absolute are contained in sunt in the substance of absolute reality or of the utmost perfection, things are not parts of God. We have seen that. In turn, what we see in that test very clearly, the derivation of finite things is explained in terms of the addition of limits, suggesting once again a top-down Neoplatonic model characterized by the priority of the absolute or perfect. Limited things originate from what is purely positive and therefore beyond all determinations through the addition of determinations and therefore negations. Finally, and here I come to the issue of omniscience and the intellect of God containing also representing also negations and limitations. Finally, Leibniz also seems to need some version of the Neoplatonic distinction between one and intellect to counter the objection that God's knowledge of limited things introduces negation in God. As we have seen, as he acknowledges in the quotation I have already read, the intellect, divine intellect, includes also representation of negations. Leibniz seems to think that the mere mental representation of negations by the divine mind does not threaten the ontological pure positive of the essence of God. And once again, it seems to me that he is here availing himself of a Neoplatonic model of a distinction between the one where there is a pure positivity and for the and the one is ineffable and all that, and then the first hypostasis, the intellect, where there is a plurality, and with plurality, for the very fact that is plurality, there is also some form of negation. Thanks to its containing all things purely eminently, the divine essence is in itself still beyond any determination. For Leibniz, this seems sufficient to ensure the absolute positivity of God's own nature or essence. Conclusion, and here again we come a full circle to my first talk. Strictly speaking, creatures for Leibniz are limited rather than finite, since through its confused perceptions, each individual substance involves the infinite. And there is a wonderful example of that in this test, the annotatiuncule subitanee. The crucial feature which keeps created substances from matching the absolute infinity of God is not activity, is not indivisibility or simplicity. Also created monads are active, indivisible and simple, but the lack of pure positivity which comes with any limitation. Pure positivity provides Leibniz with the needed metaphysical tool for distinguishing between God and creatures and for narrowly escape pantheism. And he says in Calculus Consequentiarum, and in truth, only the notion of God is purely positive and involves no limitation or negation. Insofar as the divine essence cannot contain formally any limited perfection, limited perfections require distinct substances as their bearers. Pure positivity is what ultimately distinguishes the divine nature from the nature of created things. Pure positivity, is what justifies, at least to Leibniz's satisfaction, the metaphysical need for limited substances distinct from God. Far from being a rabbit magically pulled out from a hat in a feeble attempt to rescue the ontological argument, pure positivity plays a key role in Leibniz's metaphysics, aligning with some of its most fundamental and well-known ontological commitments. So that is it, and let me stop sharing. Okay, so here, as you see, I like a circle, the sphere, coming back to the first talk, trying to embrace in that also what we have explored along the way, primary matter, metaphysical evil, and now pure positivity. Okay, what I propose to do is to take a 5 minutes break, and then we will discuss. We have a good 40 minutes for doing that. And please feel free to refer also to previous papers and to metaphysical evil in particular. Okay, so 5 minutes, see you back around 11:20 in Italy.